out. We'll do that in a minute. I thought my message was going to get preached before I got up. Come up here and lay those things out. We have a job to do. We have a job to do. God laid some things in my heart. JR contacted me. God laid some things in my heart. Well, when God laid the things in my heart, God laid the people on my heart too. So some of you come here tonight going to get something and you didn't even know that you come here to receive anything. But I'm telling you, in the name of Jesus Christ, the name above all names, above every manner of sickness and disease, above every devil, you will receive in Jesus' name. We got to talking here at the beginning of the service about praise. And about the word. And about us having a job to do. It was even mentioned that God gives us something and expects us to go out and give it unto someone else. I'm going to read one little verse to you. One little verse to you. It covers every one of us. Out of the second epistle of Peter, chapter 1 and verse 13. The Bible says, "Yea, I think it meet, as long as I am in this tabernacle, to stir you up by putting you into remembrance." We're going to go one more place. 2 Timothy, if I can find it. 2 Timothy, chapter 2. Chapter 1 and verse 6. "Wherefore I put thee in remembrance, that thou stir up the gift of God, which is in thee by the putting on of my hands." And I want to speak to you all in just a little while. If you all would allow me, and if God would allow me, on the thought, you've got to use what you've got. Now, God has gave us something. David wrote and said, "I have hidden thy word in my heart that I might not sin against thee." So where is that at? The word should be inside of you. Jesus said, he spoke through Paul in 2 Corinthians 6 and 16 and said, "I will dwell in them. I will dwell in them and I will walk with them and I will be their God and they will be my people." In Luke 17 and 21, Jesus told the disciples, said, "The kingdom of God is inside you." So you have to use what you've got. Elisha was down in the field, minding his own business, plowing with daddy's ox. Daddy's ox had daddy's yokes on him. Elijah had been up on the mountain. And the Lord spoke to Elijah and said, "I want you to go down into the valley. You'll want to find Elisha down there plowing the field." He said, "When you see him, I want you to lay your mantle upon him." So Elijah goes down into the valley, walks up past Elisha, and just says, "Brother Wayne just laid the mantle upon him." That right there was enough to make him break the yoke, sacrifice the oxen, and leave daddy and go following after the man of God. Now, later on down the line, Elijah tells him, says, well, the prophets come to him and they say, I guess you know your master's going to be taken away. He said, yeah, I know. And Elijah said, well, I got to go down here. Elijah says, go on, I'm a-going with you. Well, no, I got to go over here. Well, go on, I'm a-going with you. Well, I'm going to go over here. Well, go on, I'm a-going with you. Because if I see you go, I'm going to get what belongs to me. So tired of this boy following me. What do you want? He said, I pray thee, give me a double portion. He said, you ask a hard thing. But nevertheless, if you see me go up, you'll receive it. And about that time, the chariot and the whirlwind come through, picked him up, and Elisha fell down and cried out unto God. The mantle was taken up, and it was dropped. Elisha picks it up. Where be the God of Elijah? Smotes the Jordan. And the waters part. 17 notable miracles done by the prophet Elijah. 14 done by the prophet Elisha. One after he was dead, carried out by a man being thrown down upon his bones, and the power of God being so in the man that his bones brought the dead back to life. Fire, fire in my bones. Holy Ghost fire in my bones. We got to use what we've got. God, and I like it because you'll say, I like it, dude. It squirts up on me. It's refreshing. God said, and I like saying God said because those that don't believe go home and look for it and then they find out who God was. You see, this week, the devil's talked to me a whole lot. And I've come even more to find out that I don't like him. But I found out that we've got one thing in common. We believe in one God. God said, I give unto you power to tread upon serpents and upon scorpions and over all power of the enemy. That's right. That's what the word said. I didn't write it. The Holy Ghost wrote it. He said, the words that I speak to you, they are spirit and they are life. If we can get it into our minds that the man standing behind the pulpit is not the one doing the preaching, but the Holy Ghost that dwells on the inside of the man. Lord God, the places that we could go and the things that we could see. Impartation is what this is all about. God gives to you for you to go down the road and to give to somebody else. Sister Pam, come here, ma'am. I used water, put on my hand, laid it upon her, and you could see where the water that was on me transferred unto her. Jesus said, those that believe on me as the scriptures had said, out of their belly shall flow rivers of living water. Why? So those that are athirst can drink. God puts it in us, Brother Wayne, to give unto somebody else. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about this. You see, there was a boy born in the land of Egypt, and his name was Moses. He was born a Hebrew, and the Pharaoh had said that all the little boys under the age of 2 were to be killed. But they took this little boy and they put him in the bulrush and they sent him on down the river. Well, Pharaoh's daughter found him. God's good. While Pharaoh's daughter was aggravating daddy to keep the baby was sent home with its mommy to be weaned. And then he was sent back to live in the house and eat the food of the one that set forth to kill him. God's good. God's good. That's how Isaiah could write, "No weapon formed against you shall prosper." Now Moses grew up in the king's house. Not as a servant, but as a king. Moses goes down one day and he's looking over the land that he was to one day maybe sit and rule over. As he was there, he seen a Hebrew getting beat up on. Done something to him, Sister Pam. He knew, deep down he knew what was on the inside of him. And it made him angry. And he slew the taskmaster. And then in fear he run and hid. 40 years. 40 years on the backside of a desert. Herding daddy-in-law's sheep. Learning for 40 years how to be a leader. Knowing there was something going on. One day, he's walking along. I can see him now with his little staff. Moses. That's my Jesus voice. Y'all like it? Take your shoes off. For the ground that you stand on is holy ground. A bush being burnt but not consumed. Speaking to him. Probably thought, Brother Wayne, that the heat had got to him. He said, "I want you to go down there, Moses. I want you to tell Pharaoh to let my people go." "Well, Lord, I can't speak." "Don't matter, Moses. Because I want you to take your brother Aaron with you. He'll speak for you. Now go." Moses, with his staff in his hand, wanders down into Egypt. Pharaoh. Couldn't you hear him as he walked in that hall? Pharaoh. "Let God's people go." Could you imagine the fear come into Pharaoh's heart? The one that he had raised, that he had fed, that when he was a babe probably put on the back of the horse and took him and showed him, all the pyramids and all the things that the slaves, the Hebrews, were building for him. Had a revelation. Now we read, where Moses took his staff, stuck it into the Nile, turned the water into blood. We read where they were stuck, a mountain on this side, a mountain on this side, a sea in front of them, and an army behind them. Moses raising his rod, stretching it out over the sea, and the wind all night long blew and parted the waters. We read later where they become thirsty and brings water from a rock. Then we read where the enemy was prevailing against them, and Moses took that rod and he stood up on that mountain with his hand in the air. And every time that he got tired and that staff began to drop, the enemy began to prevail. But thank God for people. Thank God for people that may not have the staff, but have the hands to come up and help the man with the staff hold it up. You got to use what you got. Moses had a staff, and Moses used it. We read where Elijah had called a famine in the land, a drought, which would produce a famine. Crops can't grow. Animals ain't got nothing to drink. They're going to die. He told the king, he said, it's not going to rain for a space of 3.5 years. God put him down by the brook. Sent him ravens with meat and bread of the morning and meat and bread of the evening. But we read where the brook dried up. And the king probably ran out of meat. He said, arise and go to Zarephath. There's a widow there that will sustain you. So he goes down there, and I can see him as he's sitting in the gate. And I can see her out there now, picking up her twigs. He said, hey, make me a cake. Make me a cake. He said, as the Lord liveth, I have not but a little cruse of oil and a little meal. And I'm going to bake me and my son a cake, and we're going to eat, and we're going to die. He said, make me a cake. And as the Lord liveth, the cruse of oil or the pot of meal will not go dry until rain falls down from the earth. So she took what she had, and she made a cake for the man of God, that he may live. Had enough for her and her son to live till the drought was over. You got to use what you got, because there's a purpose in it. There's a purpose in it. ways of God. We're hewn up on a mountainside. And down in the valley was the Philistines. They had a big, bad giant with them, known for taking the head off of everybody that got in his way. Never had lost a battle. So arrogant and so confident in himself that he stood there defying the armies of God, taunting them, Sister Pam, day and night. Who's going to come down and face me? Who is coming to face me? Who has got it in them to come and face me? Lord, there's a little shepherd boy. Shepherd boy. Brothers in the army that was being defiled. Brothers that sat back while the giant taunted. Because they didn't have, it's not that they didn't have something, but they didn't have what they needed to defeat the giant. You see, David sat back up on the hill, watching daddy's sheep, keeping away the wolves and the bear and the lion. I can see him now, kicked back against a tree, strumming a harp. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Oh, here comes a bear. Getting practice, man. See, God will put you somewhere for you to get practice. So when the time come and the giant was down in there, who's going to come out and face me? Little David jumped up and said, let me at him. Let me at him. Well, you're just a little shepherd boy. It ain't about me. It's about my shepherd. I might be a shepherd boy, but I have a shepherd that's going to lead me into the place of victory over this uncircumcised Philistine. He goes down there. I can see Goliath now. Some say he stood 9 feet tall. My Bible says he was 13 foot tall. It don't matter if you're 9 foot tall or if you're 13 foot tall. That's pretty tall.
Come on. Come on, brother.
Probably laughed when little old David come down there. Boy, don't you see my spear? It's as a weaver's beam. This spear had a cuff on it. When he would throw it, it would hit its target. And he could pull his target back to him. See my sword? This is the sword I use when I'm going to cut somebody's head off. I see him now. So? So? Now see, people will preach to you that David was scared. He was not scared. The three Hebrew children were not scared. Daniel was not scared. The only people that will preach to you that they are scared is the ones that scared themselves.
Amen.
So, you come at me with a spear and a sword. Oh, but big boy, I come to you in the name of the Lord. They tell you that the name is not important. David was coming against the enemy with the name when the name was not even known, when the name was still secret. David was coming at the enemy with the name. The name of Jesus is above every name. David had went down and got him 5 smooth stones. Only needed one. But Goliath had 4 brothers. Tell you something, there's always going to be another giant. Years later, they run into one, and he turned around, had 6 fingers on each hand and 6 toes on each foot. And Lord, I can see David now as that giant turned around, and he thought he was looking into the face of Goliath. But David knew the shepherd and knew that the stone that brought Goliath down could bring down the brother also.
Amen.
You've got to use what you got. The empty oil bottle with a mustard seed in it. Paul wrote in the book of Romans. He said, God, now I've heard it preached and stood up in the pulpit and said, God has dealt to every man a measure of faith. The Bible says that God has dealt unto man the measure of faith. How much faith is that? Enough to get the job done. It's enough to get the job done. He said, when they come back and they couldn't cast out no devil, why can't we cast out no devil? O ye of little faith, if thou have faith the size of a grain of mustard seed, ye can say into that mountain, be thou removed, and it will part into yonder sea. So what is the measure of faith? Well, I find it funny that he said, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, the littlest of seeds. But you plant this bad boy. You go out every day. You weed up around it. You get the soil loose around it that it can take up in water, and it grows to be one of the biggest bushes that there ever was.
Amen.
See, people look at certain people and say, I wish I could have the faith that they had. You started out with the same faith that they started out with.
Amen. Amen.
Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. That's when it grows. It don't matter if you still have a seed. That's enough to get the job done. That's enough for you to say, mountain, get out of my way. Problem, get out of my way. Whatever is keeping me from receiving what God has for me, get out of my way. You've got to use what you've got. Second Kings chapter 4. We read that a man had died. And he died owing a bunch of money or something to the creditor. Now back in those days, when a lump sum was owed, and you couldn't play, or you couldn't pay, they would take your children to be slaves until that debt was worked off. Now, the woman of the house, not having any money, taking care of two children, was in dire need. Here's another one of them miracles from that one that got the double portion. Well, evidently he had knew her husband. He said, "Now, you tell me, what have you got? See, you got to use what you've got. Sometimes you may think that what you got ain't good enough, but God give it to you. And what he gives it to you, oh God, it's good enough to take care of the need. It's good enough to take care of the job. When you join the United States Army, they don't give you a machine gun that's going to jam up on you. They don't give you one that don't have no clips. They equipped you to do your job." Well, I was in Sunday school. We used to sing a little song. "I'm in the Lord's army. I'm in the Lord's army." You know what that means? Everything that I need in order to overcome what life throws at me, I've got. Now, he asked this little woman, he said, "What do you got?" She said, "I have nothing but just a little cruse of oil. That's all I have. I want you to go borrow every pot. Every pot." I always tell it like this. If they hadn't run out of pot, I didn't mean like it. If they hadn't run out of pots, they'd have still been pouring oil out over her. All this time, they'd have still been over there pouring out oil. I don't know why Grandma gave me this, but they've done it for generations. We just got to keep pouring. But see, he said, "I want you to go. I want you to borrow every pot you can find. And I want you to pour." And she kept pouring. And she kept pouring. Till she kept pouring. And she turned around and looked at her son. She said, "Get me another pot." I said, "They ain't no more. You done used every pot in the county. They ain't no more." "Hey, man of God, we ain't got no more. We ain't got nothing else to put it in." So we'll take it. Take it. Sell it. Pay off that creditor. You see, some of us in life, the devil dealt us a bad hand. And we played those cards. And things got taken away from us. But we got to use what we got to get them back. Got to use what you got. If all you got's the word. Jesus was in the wilderness fasting 40 days, and the devil come at him and said, "If thou be the Son of God, command these stones to be made bread." He said, "Well, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but out of every word that cometh out of the mouth of God." If all you got's the word, you got to use what you got. If all you got is praise, use what you've got. You see, the Bible says to be sober and to be vigilant. For your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. Now see, he is as a roaring lion. But I serve a God that is the Lion of the tribe of Judah, or the Lion of the tribe of praise. When I begin to praise, that as a lion has to run, because my praise makes my lion roar. A few years ago, I made it a mission of mine to, when I seen a plan of the devil, to run into it, stir up the hornet's nest, and break out the raid. I don't like him. I don't even want him to think that I even care about him in the least little bit. He is a squiggly worm. He is a maggot. He holds no power. And he does not shake me in the least little bit. Now, I've told you, Hamilton's Creek, use what you got. Use what you got. But there's individuals here that I gave you some. And I want you to come up here and I want you to stand. Just stand across here. God's got a word for you. Well, how do you know? Because God told me.
That's right, brother. Come on.
JR contacted me. I said, Lord, what do I go over and say? It really doesn't matter, because you all like the word so much, I could preach Mary had a little lamb. Because she did. That's right. Because she did. But I preached this message a long time ago, and the Lord brought this back to my remembrance. I said, okay, just like Gideon. There you go, Lord. Let it rain, but might let that stay dry, because I won't be sure. Well, I go to church that day. Daddy preaches and uses three of the examples that I just used here tonight. On the way home that day, God kept dropping people into my spirit. Said, I want you to go down and get 5 smooth stones. Well, where do you want? Go to the old baptizing hole right down from the church. Well, where am I going to find a stick? It's going to be down there at the baptizing hole. I go down there, walk right up on 5 smooth rocks, turn around and look, and it was like a big ball of sunshine laying on a stick. So I know. My mommy always said, you got to know that you know that you know. My word tells me that my sheep know my voice, and a stranger they will not follow. I'm glad I know the voice of the Lord. Sometimes it comes in like static on a radio, but I can still hear it, Jamie. I don't even think you know what's on the inside of you. But I see you leading a people. A people that is in bondage. A people that the church world has forgot about. And I see you leading them because I see that God has put something yet at a lead, son, lead. Just like him. I don't think you know what God's put on the inside of you. But let me tell you something. The devil's scared. He's scared, Blake. He's scared of you. He desires to sift you as wheat. But in the name of Jesus, the spirit of David dwells with you, the warrior of God, to take down every giant. Are you ready for this? I don't know if you are or not, but you better be. God has given you what it takes to make bread. To make bread and bring it into the congregation to be broken and to be eaten of. I have set before thee an open door, and I say unto thee, walk, open your mouth, I will fill it. Do not think of what they may say, for whatever they speak against you shall be returned unto them. Speak my word, speak my word, speak my word. Speak my word. Donna, do you love me?
I love you, Jesus.
Feed my sheep. Satan has just tried to destroy you even after you come to God. But thus saith the word of the Lord, no weapon, no weapon, no weapon formed against thee shall prosper. You've got what it takes to get restored unto you what the locust hath eaten. Awaken, awaken, awaken. You plant a seed. You plant a seed. That seed don't sprout up overnight. But I see your porch decorated with a welcome home banner. They coming home. Because I have given thee oil to pour, the creditor shall not win. Sell your oil. Give your oil. Give your oil. Give your oil. Your children shall be saved in the name of Jesus.
My
That's off the lid, ain't it? I gotta go with what I feel led to do. Come on, we're gonna talk to your mountain. Well, I'm gonna walk with you, you're gonna talk to your mountain. Go back there and open that door. I've equipped you to succeed. You're not going under. Matter of fact, you're not going over. You're going through it. You can't tie it out of your head. Oh, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Well, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
That's the way we need to be with him. We don't need to be like this. Well, devil's here, I better sit down. Jump up in the Holy Ghost and drop kick the evil out of him. Hunter, I don't know where you boys go, but you all go. You all go, and you go together. Come here, both of you. Let me tell you something right now. When I look at them two, I see me and Robbie. God has gave, he put a, we never had a relationship, Larry. Until I got in church. And the devil has tried every way in the world to rip me and him apart. Jesus walked along one day, and there in the boat sit James and John, the sons of Zebedee. Jesus called them the sons of thunder. When these boys speak, trembles. Hell trembles when these boys speak. Get it, Blake. Get it. Get it, boys. Get it. Get it. God's put it under your feet. Get it. 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 I know some of the musicians are in the floor, but hey, come up and take us to Beulah. If you need prayer, if you need prayer, God says, receive ye the Holy Ghost. He can tell you that 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 he can tell you that. Some of you ladies pray with her. Can't let that fall. I want you all to understand something. I have never in my life claimed to be a prophet. I have never claimed to have the gift of prophecy. But I know the voice of the Lord. God says you ain't seen nothing yet. Come on, I can talk over you singing. Take us to Beulah.
I'm on a train bound for Beulah. Girls calling, come aboard.
By Messiah. Messiah.